Hello everyone, welcome back to another Factional Fight Plays Wurm Online. My name is Brian, that's my brother Adam over there, and today we are going to be talking about skill grind, or gaining skill, and the ins and outs of that. I don't know if we've ever talked specifically about that, have we, Adam?
A little bit here and there, but not to the extent that we're going to talk about it today, I think.
This is not to... we did talk about skill gaining in another episode. I can't remember which one that was, but it was more about skill gaining a harvesting skill or something like that. Is that right?
Yeah. I think today we're going to be focusing on imping skills. So, and we'll talk a little bit about the difference between that, but yeah.
Specifically about imping and the ins and outs of that. So I think we should just jump right to it. What do you think?
Yep, I think that's it.
Let's do that. We are back, and I don't know if anybody in the chat can see, but I might be a little bit more laggy. I was supposed to get better internet, and I now have worse internet. I don't know how that happens. My internet is so bad. It's below 1 megabit per second, if anybody else can compare that with anything. It's really bad, and that's up and download speed. But we're doing this anyway, so you should at least be able to hear me, even if I'm jumping around. The video is probably not very good. But that doesn't stop us from skill grinding in Wurm. let's go. What are we doing today exactly? We are going to be picking. We're each going to pick a skill to grind that we've always wanted to skill up, but never did. Mm-hmm. So, and after that, we're just going to go and skill grind, talk about it, talk about what our tips would be to skill grind, what we're actually going to do to skill grind based on our experience, and hopefully people in the chat will be able to help us out, maybe if we don't know what we're doing. Which is quite possible, because I half the time don't know what I'm doing. So let's jump. Tell me right off the bat, what did you pick, Adam?
Well, I decided to go with cloth tailoring. It's a skill that I sort of worked on a little bit. My skill's pretty low still, but it's something that I'd like to have higher because of the new tapestries that we have, the new cloth items that are there, like the carpets and stuff, so it would be nice to have that skill.
And I have chosen the one skill that I've always wanted to skill up and have never ever bothered to, because no time, I'm just doing too much stuff, and that's natural substances. And the only reason I want to skill up natural substances, as many people here will know, is I want to make good dies. That's it. Mm-hmm. I just want to be able to color things. So we got to figure out how I'm going to color things better and how Adam is going to make better tapestries or higher level tapestries. Let's start with cloth tailoring.
All right.
How's that? Sure. So I don't think we're going to do the ins and outs. Everybody knows you need your tools, you create items, and then I assume we all know how to improve items. That's not what we're here to talk about. We're more here to talk about the tricks involved, I guess. Mm-hmm. don't know, but if anybody's in the chat and thinking, I don't know how to improve items, just let us know and we'll talk about it. But I'm just assuming here that everyone knows the basics.
Yeah, like if there's anything that we do that doesn't seem to make sense, you can always ask. Or if you think that we're doing something and you know a better way of doing it, then by all means you can just say in the chat here, or if you're watching on YouTube, you can leave it in the comments. We're always learning. I feel like I learned something new nearly every week in this game, and I've been playing for quite a while, so yeah.
And here's something that we just learned this month. How to pull four animals with a mooring rope. How to lead four animals.
Right, with a single mooring rope. Yeah.
One mooring rope, you can lead four animals. Yeah, there you go. How did we not know that before? It's everywhere. Just everybody knows that but us. Why didn't you guys tell us in the chat?
I know, seriously. I don't...
Anyway, let's go. So let's start with the cloth tailoring.
Okay, now my cloth tailoring setup is actually quite rough considering it's in our old building. And just sort of strewn about here.
It's the oldest building and we haven't done anything here. Yeah, anyway,
okay, so yeah.
What do you need? You need items, right?
Yeah, I need items. Okay. Yeah, so
at this point the best way to level cloth tailoring would be what? So we know from the previous episode that if I wanted to level mining, I go out, I take a specific tool, and I like a pickaxe, and I just start mining. Mm-hmm. I want to go woodcutting, and I take my tool and I woodcut. So for cloth tailoring, do I just go and I create items, and I level that way, or we improve items that way? What's the best?
For cloth tailoring?
For cloth tailoring.
Yeah, for the cloth tailoring, the best way is to improve. It's an improving skill, which means that you have items that you can improve with. And if you're trying to get a skill up and you can improve something to get that skill, that's like 100% of the way, 100% of the time, the best way to do it.
All right. So if you can. Actually take an item and improve it, that's how you get your skill up.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, what are you going to do?
Okay, so I think that I'm going to do cloth gloves.
And is there any reason for cloth gloves? Or?
Yeah, cloth gloves is the best because it's the smallest item, like it has the least weight. And therefore, when you use the string to improve it, it uses the least amount of resources there. If you have unlimited resources or tons and tons of resources, then it doesn't really matter what you're going to imp. But for me, I have just a modest farm. So, yeah.
So you're saying no matter what you, like, depending on what you're imping, mm-hmm. it changes how much of what the cloth, I don't know what it is for cloth tailoring.
Yeah.
That you use up, the string that you use up?
That's right, the string that you use up. Yeah, it's a small...
And that's specifically based off of, what is it, the weight.
The weight,
in this
exactly,
game.
Exactly.
So do you know how that works?
Do I know how...
How, like, the conversion rate? If my item weighed 4 pounds,
right,
when I'm imping, how much string does it take?
I think for every skill, it works the same. It takes, what is it, 5% of the weight of the item from your resource. So if you're imping something that's 10 weight, then it'll take 0.5 of your resource, 0.5 kilograms of your resource. So, like, for example, a large Wow. anvil is 10 weight. So every time you imp it with an iron lump, it'll take 0.5 kilograms of lump. It's a pain in the butt, but
wow,
the reality of it. But cloth glove only weighs 0.1, so you're really only going to take 0.005 of your string each time. So that's pretty nice. So
that's why you do it.
Yeah.
Because it takes less resources. Mm-hmm. I see. But is there any... Like, other than that, you're saying all the items... skill, like, give you the same amount of skill points?
No, actually, there's some items that seem to be a little bit more difficult than others. And it's not that you get more skill per action, but I think it gives you more skill, more ticks on average. But it's hard to say because there's no, like, formula or there's no indication in the game. You sort of have to go off by experience. Imp something for an hour and then try something else for another hour and see which one gave you a total net skill gain that was better. It's one of these things where there's no list that you can go look up or to see which one's best. Really, though, from my experience, it doesn't matter too much. Like, there's not one magical thing that's going to double the skill gain compared to something else. You know what I mean?
So it's almost like you can hardly tell a difference between items.
Right.
But
you can hardly tell a difference.
There might be like a randomness to it where
right.
You gain that you people will imp with an item and they'll get more experience than imping with another item for some odd reason, for whatever reason, and that will be like end up being a rule.
Yeah.
That they'll spread it everywhere. Oh yeah. My god, I imped cloth, whatever, barding today, and
it got amazing skill.
Much more.
Yeah.
Amazing skill. Spread the word.
Right.
I don't know. We'll never know. We'll never. There'll always be items that seem seemingly better skill up than others.
That's the thing in this game is that it's very hard to take. What other people say, and then at the same time we're basically saying stuff to you guys, and so take what we say with a grain of salt, take what other people say with a grain of salt. The best resource you have is your own experience with things.
That's what's great about this game. Mm-hmm. You never know. There's always this hint of mystery.
Yeah,
and even when we think we figured it out,
exactly,
we still never know.
It's one of the things I love
things
about this game.
Things could change and they could not tell us.
Right.
So, what exactly are you doing? You're creating cloth gloves.
Yeah, I'm creating a bunch of them.
How many are you creating?
Well, I mean, I probably more than I need. That's the general rule of thumb.
This is more just so that people think, we're not just skilling up this item. There's two ways of thinking. I'm going to be the cloth tailor. I'm going to make cloth tailoring items for my village, and then that's it. I'm not going to do any more. And then there's the way of thinking of, I am going to just level my skill. My skill is more important than the items that I make. I am doing cloth tailoring to gain my skill and not doing cloth tailoring to specifically, I don't know, help someone or to make myself items or anything like that. And in this case, we are leveling our skill just for the skill.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing that one. So in this case, you're making like a ton of gloves because it's easier just to have a giant pool of items to imp.
Right.
Is that right?
Right. It's my rule of thumb is make more than you need. It always will motivate you to have that extra few down here that you need to get to.
Okay, so you get to that point. You made your items. I remember back in the day, we had tool belts that held two tools,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And so in order for us to imp stuff, we would be imping things from our inventory. We would have to double-click the item, and then we would right-click... Mm-hmm. Right-click the item that we're imping, or we would double-click the tool, right-click the item we were imping, and say improve or cut or whatever we're doing.
Yeah.
But now we have the tool belt, and you load the tools onto the tool belt, and then we have these hot buttons. Do we want to talk anything about that?
Yeah. I think that this is part of the thing. I mean, the tool belt is so invaluable to imping. Like, I remember when I first started and we didn't have large tool belts and we were imping stuff, and the way that I would do it is I would go into my inventory and say, oh, I need my scissors, and then I would go over to, well, nothing here needs scissors, but let's say I go to my needle, okay, and I would go down here and I would right click and click improve or whatever it is, slip stitch here, and I'd have to, and I'd do that for every action, and it was so tedious. And then later I found that you can just put your tools on the tool belt, assign hotkeys, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, however many you need. And so, like, notice I press 2 and I switch to my scissors, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So, I don't know. It just completely changed the way that I imped.
But just like any other item in the game, tool belts improve as you level them.
Right.
And they gain tool belt slots. Where would you say, for people that don't have a tool belt, like, and you can go out and you can buy tool belts with, let's say, up to 10 slots. I think 10's the max.
Mm-hmm.
Should I go out and buy a 10-slot tool belt?
I don't even have
a 10-slot. Where is that threshold between I don't know, price and usability?
Yeah. You know, it's very nice to have 10 slots. I only have 9, and I find myself often in that situation where I wish I had that extra slot. And it usually comes down when I'm doing a couple things at the same time. Like, I have my imping set here, and I also want, you know, like a hatchet, a shovel, a pickaxe. I always want to have rope and my flint and steel on there. That's always my last two slots. You know. And I guess, you know, now that we have this new feature that they added on, you know, multiple tool belt. Oh, and I just lost all my stuff. Yeah, tool belt. What do you call it? Profiles? I think this nullifies our whole episode on tool belt profiles.
We created an episode. It's done.
Yeah.
they implemented it into the game. It's so much better now. It's what it should be.
It is what it should be. And, you know, it does give you more versatility, but I like always having the things I need on here set. And so I'd say 9 is pretty good for me. I wish I had that 10th slot.
So you want more. You want all 10.
It would be nice to have that
10. I'm finding the opposite. Like, I don't need all 10. I find that even with 10, I have empty slots.
Oh, yeah.
That I'm not using. I need the amount. This is what I need. I need everything that I'm going to imp. So if I'm doing carpentry, I need the 5 slots for for the tools that I need, including the log. I need 1 for a rope.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe like another 1. I don't know, a sickle or something that. Sickle's always handy because I can go out and just start picking sprouts or something like that, harvest. I don't know, what do you guys think in the chat here? Do you find that you need, like, what slots, how many slots do you have? And do you find you need more or less than what you have? I'm actually quite interested to hear.
Mm-hmm.
You can let us know when you hear that. But, so, even so, you have that. You have, you load all your tools onto mm-hmm. your tool belt, and then you, instead of right-clicking the item, we've learned over the years to bind the improve and repair action.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Talk a little bit about that. Why do we do that? So much faster.
I know.
That's why.
So, yeah, we bind the improve and repair action, like, really next like close to each other. I think I use G for improve and T for repair.
Yeah, and I use spacebar for improve and R for repair.
Yeah, it doesn't.
That's a nice split for my fingers.
Yeah, it doesn't matter which one that you use, but as long as they're like next to each other. Now, I use both whenever I'm improving a single item. So this is for quick improving. Like, you already got the skill up and you don't really care about gaining skill and you just want to get that item as high as you can, as fast as you can. And so the strategy I'd use is I'll choose the tool, improve, and then repair. And then I might even queue up improve and repair again. That way, if it damages the tool, you damage the item, then it'll repair it and start improving it again. But when I'm grinding, I don't do that.
What do you do when you're grinding?
When I'm grinding, I'll just improve. And that's because I want to queue up 5 actions. Right, so here, like, I'll pick my string and I'll just go 5 items. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that's because I have 5.
So we should all queue up 5.
Well, that'll all depend on how many actions you're able to queue. I can queue up maximum 5 actions, and it doesn't use up all my stamina.
So it's based on how many actions, or it's based on how much stamina we have?
Yeah, it's both actually. You have to have the number of actions first. And really, the idea is you want to improve so that you still have stamina at the end of your last improve action. But you want to use up as much as you can.
So the whole goal here is to queue up actions to use up your stamina before your stamina runs out.
Pretty much. Is that right? Yeah. Now, the reason why you want
to
do that...
What happens when your stamina runs out?
When your stamina runs out...
Before that... Yeah. What were you going to say?
I think if the stamina runs out before you finished your action, what's going to happen is you're going to get a fraction of the amount of skill gain that you normally would have. Like, it'll decrease the amount of skill you get for that action, so... You don't want to do that.
Like, how much could it possibly be? Like 10%?
No, it's like it reduces it by like 90%. Yeah, it's really bad.
Oh my, 90%?
Yeah.
That's not worth it.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. So, I just opened up my skill tab so you can take a look at how it's going. And I'm going to queue up 5 actions and we're just going to take a look at... you know what the problem is? I have these in the order that's... different than what I'm used to, so let me just fix that first.
How about that skill tracker?
Yeah. Oh, we'll talk about the skill tracker in a second. I'll bring that up as well. But let's just take a look at the individual skills going up, because it's better to see the ticks when you do this.
Yes. And this is something that you change in the settings.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to see as many decimal places as possible, for sure.
So there's like a thing in the settings, if you go under the text tab, to change it so that the skill gain tab always updates.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's defaulted to 0.1
yeah.
per 0.1 increase or something like that. But
yeah,
you do that because you want to actually see, I don't know. The differences, the changes.
The point is that I want to optimize my skill gain, so I want to keep track of like little things that I notice. Like, for example, there, that was the third action in my queue. Cloth tailoring increased by 0.03. So I look at this column as like a percent of a... This is 3% of a full skill gain, or full level, or whatever. And you'll notice that if I get the next tick, look, goes to 4%, and that's because the timers are longer. But as well, another thing that I do is I'll use my higher COC tools later in the queues. So like, I'll use needle actions last because I have a 99 COC needle. And that makes it so that not only do I have longer queue timer for that tool, it's also higher COC, so it multiplies and gives you like lots of skill gain if it gives you a skill tick on that one. Oh, here's like a lot of needle options. This is great.
Oh, wow. So when you're skilling it up, I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought. You're skilling up and your stamina is going down, and as your stamina goes down, your timer increases.
Right.
And when your timer increases, you gain more skill.
Per tick. Per action, yeah.
Per action.
Now, some people argue that it doesn't really matter because if you... It takes longer and you get a proportional amount of extra skill, so why not just do shorter actions? And the reason is because if I queue it up like that, on the very final action, if I use a high COC, then I'll get that, like, I get that extra bonus skill compared to if I were just doing it, you know, one action at a time and letting my stamina refresh.
So you feel that the queuing actually will give you better skill gain.
Yeah, and then on the flip side, I'll use like my low COC tools for the first action, so that the shorter timer isn't, you know, wasted or whatever. I mean, it's wasted still, but like for skills where you have to have a tool where the COC doesn't help you. Like for example, smithing, the tempering action. COC, mm-hmm. You don't get that. So I always put water actions first.
So you always queue up based on how much COC is on your item.
Right.
Or for people who don't know, Circle of Cunning.
Right.
Which is an enchantment that gives you more skill per action.
Exactly. Okay, sorry, what were you
gonna say? You don't have COC on your tools, get somebody to put it on your tools.
Absolutely.
That would definitely help your skill gain.
Right.
So I was going to talk. So now that you talked a little bit about your tools, I mean, what kind of tools do I use? I know when we were when we were doing the optimized skill gain episode about mining, we said that you use low quality tools with high COC to get the best harvesting skill up. Harvesting skill up.
Why don't
Is that
we...
the same? So you want low quality tools for and high COC for when you're imping?
Yeah, no. No.
Yes.
No. No, the answer is no. I mean, there was a
You have to give me new tools.
There was a community question a while ago, and I was saving it up for this episode, so I think we'll bring it up here because it's pretty much asking the same thing. It was submitted by Renewed Path, and he said, when using skillers to grind a certain skill, is it all the same concept? Low skill tool for imping items, etc. Does that give better skill gain? Or are there items that don't make a difference in the skill gain ticks produced? I think that's two separate questions, but the first part is pretty much asking, does it matter what your tool is when you're imping or harvesting or whatever? And it matters. It matters a big deal.
Why does it matter?
Like when you're harvesting, like mining or wood cutting or something like that, we've talked about that in our optimized skill gain episode before. And you want a very specific quality tool, and that was to produce specific quality products that will result in
skill gain. You know why? You can't fail at harvesting.
Right. Well,
but you can fail at imping.
The fail at harvesting is getting a 1 quality, 1.00 quality. That would be considered your fail. So there, you want to reduce those, but you also want to reduce the high end. Like, if you succeed very well, you sort of don't want to succeed very well, and you don't want to fail miserably. You want to sort of be in between there.
And we talked a lot about that in the optimized skill gain episode.
Yeah, but for imping...
Imping,
you don't want to fail as well, but there's no real top end, or at least none that is apparent. I have found that the higher the quality of your tools, the better off in general you are. The other reason why it makes no difference is because tool quality does not affect your timer. So if you are only using COC tools, no WA, it'll be 12 seconds for every imping action on your first action, regardless of the tool quality.
But yet, tool quality does affect the action timer of, like, harvesting skills.
Right.
Why do you think that's the case?
I don't know. I mean, I guess they wanted it to be so that higher quality tools are more productive in that respect.
Yeah. I guess so, but not transfer it to imping. So in that case, you're saying, do you find that, and I've always wondered this, I don't know if anybody knows this, that if you have higher quality tools while imping, that you're more successful at gaining skill?
Personally, from my experience, I have felt that high quality tools does increase your skill gain compared to if you had low quality tools. And by low, I mean if you just had all 10 quality imping tools, like a 10 quality needle and a 10 quality scissors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're gonna find that you're failing the imping action more often, and that's gonna result in less skill gain overall. But I started a skill with one skill and 90 quality tools. All of my tools are 90 quality, and it was going real nice, really quick, and that'll take me all the way up.
Okay, how about this? I went to the market the other day, and I saw a really, really nice, really, really nice carving knife, and I was tempted to buy it. It had, it was really high quality. It was like in the 95s, and it had 90 plus COC and 90 plus WOA. And I was going to get that so that it could help me with imping. You think that would help me with imping?
It'll help you with imping. Now, that tool is perfect for production.
What do you mean?
So you have 10 items, and you just the whole goal is to get them to 90 quality as fast as you possibly can. If all of your tools were like that one, that would be the best. Get you up there really fast. Now, in terms of gaining skill, it's gonna cut your skill gain for those same.
Why would it items. Cut my skill gain?
Now, it's gonna cut your skill gain.
In don't we all sense. Want the highest quality and like biggest WOA and COC tools? That's what everybody wants.
It'll cut your skill gain in the sense that, let's say you have 5 items, you want to imp them all up to 90. Okay, so you take your high quality COC and WOA tools and do it. Okay, that'll take you a lot less time to imp compared to this other person here who just has COC and no WOA. But the person who's taking the more time is getting longer actions, and longer actions results in more skill. So let's say if it took him double the amount of time, over that double amount of time, he's going to get double the amount of skill out of those same 5 items being imped. Now, the other person might argue, well, I can imp 10 items in the same amount of time that you can imp 5 items, and over that amount of time, I'm going to get the same amount of skill as you. And I think that person would be right. I think that person would be right. You know, whenever I was imping up something, I flip-flopped between. I don't know what it is, but for a while while I was doing my blacksmithing, I just used WOA and COC on all my tools. And it was going up fine. I think I made it to 96 or 97. Mm-hmm. Actually, I'll be honest, I think I made it all the way. Since I hit 90, I think I was using WOA and COC. and that was fine. I was still going up pretty good, and I haven't looked back because most of the time, above 90 anyway, I was looking for productivity. I wanted to get items to 90 as quickly as possible. So
I didn't. You're still saying,
yeah,
that if you just wanted to skill gain, it's better just to have COC?
Yeah, so I don't even know, like, to be honest, I feel that it's pretty close. But what I'm finding is, like, let's say resource is a problem. Like, my cotton, I don't have much cotton. So here, and the string, like, that I have, like, look at the string I have is, like, 1.2 weight, and that's going to go down pretty quick. So because of that, I don't want to have WA on all my tools so that I can conserve this string. But in terms of skill gain per hour, it's hard to say. As long as you're queuing up all your actions to the end of your stamina bar, I don't really think that it affects. Because let's say your stamina bar is pretty low and you're using your WA hammer or whatever, and it still will have like a 20-second bar. And that 20-second bar is still going to give you the same amount of COC or same amount of skill tick as a 20-second bar using a tool with no COC. The only difference is that if you're using no COC on that fifth action, you're going to have a 30 or 40-second bar. So I'll be honest, I made it from 90 to 99.7 blacksmithing, only using WA tools, and it didn't feel like a grind, really. So it wasn't like it was going slow. It's going slow. Right. It's always going slow, but it went. Let's put it that way. It went up.
This seems like a fairly easy question, but while you're doing this, you do put your sleep bonus on, right?
Yeah. I think that every time that I'm doing the grind, whenever I'm doing the grind, so this would be considered grinding, standing here and just imping, just put the sleep bonus on for sure.
Okay. That's good to know.
Buddha says, only 99.7, why not 100? Weak sauce. It's going up. It's going up.
That's true, and he has a good point here, or a question here. Mm-hmm. Would you want? And I know there was an update at some point, I remember, where they said that you would gain more skill gain, and it was only for some skills. It wasn't even for all of them. That you would gain more skill when you were imping an item above your skill level.
Yeah.
I remember that update. I can't remember when it was. It was a few years ago. And it was only for blacksmithing or something like that. No, I don't know if they implemented it for every item.
I heard my thought at the beginning was that it was only for weaponsmithing. Like the way that it was worded, but these patch notes are worded, it's always in some kind of mystery. But yeah, it was clear that it was done for weaponsmithing, but I have a feeling it was also other skills.
So, if that's the case, and I think we tried to test this, and if it is better skill gain, it's not that much.
You know, the way that I look at it is that you're gonna, when the item's above your level,
this is exactly what it was. At a workshop in the art of thinking outside of the forge, smiths understood how to keep improving one item and gain better skill with less improvement instead of spewing out tons of items. So with that, the first thing we thought was, okay, we can just use one item and level it and we'll gain more skill.
Right.
And then we thought, Okay, well, it says smiths, so that means only blacksmithing, I guess. Or some sort of, like, anything in the smithing, does that include jewelry smithing? Does that include, like, all these things? We have no idea. And so, I think you tried that for a while.
You know, what I find is that it is nicer skill gain when the items are at your level or above slightly. But there does come a point where that stops, especially around that point where you're failing over and over and over again.
Yeah, and even though we had high quality tools.
Tools.
You would still fail over and over again.
I mean,
there's like a point.
Like I was doing weaponsmithing, and I think it was like my skill was around 30 or something at the time, and I would imp to 40, which was nice. Like that's, but I would take my 5 tools or whatever, or 5 weapons, imp them to 40, and then keep going. I would try to get them 41, 42, or whatever. And it was going, but I was failing a lot once I was getting up there, way past my skill. And my skill gain was like still, like, you know, I don't know if you've tried weaponsmithing, but if you have, you'll know that the skill is just so slow. And so I would be done with those 5 tools, and I would be failing, and I'd be like, okay, you know what, I'm starting a new set of tools. I would get those 5 set of tools all the way up to 40 again, and my skill would have gone up by like 0.2 in that time. And so I'm just doing that over and over and over and over and over again, and this, what is it called, this update or this like little patch note or whatever, instead of spewing out tons of items, I'm like, that's just a ton of garbage, because I probably spewed out, you know, 200 weapons or whatever in that way, and then I would go back through them all over again, but I still felt like I needed 200 weapons, and my skill is now only 60. So yeah, I gave up. It would be nice if that statement there, like if it was more like that, where you could take 5 items and then those same 5 items could take you right to the top. You know what I mean? But my feeling is that it doesn't.
What's the fun of that?
Yeah.
5 items. You've maxed out your skill. Yeah, so I don't know. I don't know if that is more than just the smithery, or if that has introduce itself to all skills, but basically we were not convinced that imping one item past your skill would be able to gain you more skill. Not convinced, but maybe it's true. Maybe somebody else knows better than us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, again, it's all a matter of experience and what you believe, because a lot of people have different opinions and we're sort of saying what we believe, but it could be wrong. But that's the beauty
of
this
game.
You never know.
So do you still have the skill window open?
Skill tracker.
I can't tell.
You're talking about the skill tracker?
So you have your skill tracker.
Or are you talking about the skill
before
tab?
Window. The skill window.
Skill tab.
Oh, open up the skill window.
Okay, so you're saying skill window, but in my mind that means either the skill tab or the skill tracker. Which one are you talking about?
Press F2.
F2. Oh, and there's a skill window, which I never had open.
There's a skill window, yeah.
Never look at this thing anymore.
We're veterans. This is funny. So the skill window. This is how you would look at what your skill level is, right? Mm-hmm. This is how we always did. We'd open up the skill window and we would look, what's green? What have we like actually been leveling? And I look at this all the time. Still. But you don't have to look at this anymore. You can open up the skill tracker.
Mm-hmm.
And let's go through it, just add cloth tailoring to it if it's not already there.
Uh,
just to
Well, on this, this isn't the computer I normally play on, so I haven't set up the skill tracker. Let's see, cloth tailoring. So let's. When I look through this menu, I'm like amazed at how many skills there are. It's just amazing. Okay, cloth tailoring. Mm. Other ones that I want to look at as well, I think, are the body skills, body control. Let's just start there.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, it's open. So why did you want me to open it?
So I never use this thing. And when it first got introduced, and I thought, okay, this is a great idea. We can track our skill gain. And I can't remember what I was thinking at the time. I was thinking that it would show me. It would be like a combination between the skill window and the skill tab.
Right.
And it would tell me exactly when I got skill ups or how much skill I got per action or something like that. Wasn't quite that. It tells you, but it is helpful. It replaces having to keep the skill window open.
Right, and not only that, I found that with the skill window, you had to scroll up and down. Like, let's say I wanted to see my characteristics and see how those are going. You not only that, you also would have to hover your mouse over each item to see the change for that session.
Right.
Skill tracker has all that information there, and it only is the skills that you want to be tracking.
You're right.
Now, the downside is that it takes time to set it up, right? Like, you act like...
Yeah, so this is how I thought. So I opened up the skill window. Here, let's see if you can...
Yeah, I'll do what you're saying.
Do this for me. So open up the skill window. And I'd want to add one of my skills to the skill tracker.
Yeah.
So I went to woodcutting, for example.
Okay.
Go to woodcutting, and I right-clicked woodcutting, and I was looking for the add to skill tracker button.
What do you mean? There is no
exactly. What do I mean? Button. There is no add to skill tracker button.
But why would you want?
But to me, that's the logical progression I'm thinking in my head. I'll open up the skills and I'll right click the skill that I want to add to the tracker. Then I'll say add to the tracker, and then it'll add it to the tracker.
Yeah, that's just wishful thinking, I think.
And then I'll go to the tracker, and then I'll be like, okay, I don't want this one there. So I right click it and I say remove from the tracker.
Yeah, it seems like it. I mean, to me, the skills tracker follows the same format as all the other windows in Wurm. Like, for example, if you're managing settings on some item, you would still have to click the OK or send button at the bottom. Or if you're looking at the deed and you change something there, you change something in that window, and then you still have to hit the send button at the bottom. I think it works. It's consistent with the other, you know, windows, other settings and stuff.
Anyway, that was just, I'm like, what am I doing wrong? I thought it was broken. I literally thought I couldn't add anything, because I had no idea where this tracker window was. I didn't know I had to open up my options and like enable it. It's not working, and then I just like didn't touch it for the longest time.
One change that I love is this, that you can change the skill tracker name. Like, there's profiles just like the tool belts that, and you can name them now. So I can put tailoring in here and go, okay. And now when I right click here and I want to load the skill tracker, I can load my tailoring skill tracker, or I can change to mining or blacksmithing. And that way I don't have to remember that blacksmithing is 2 and mining is 7, for example. That's a big change for me. I have it all set up on my other computer, just not this one.
That is great for people that use the skill tracker. I'm still not fully using it.
Yeah, you know,
I feel like I should. I feel just, like there's something that's just missing.
You just need to get it all set up. Like, enter it all in, set up all of the skills that you want for each type of skill that you... And then once you have it all set up, you're going to find that it completely replaces that skill windows where you have to, like, open sub-menus every single time you open it and have to scroll back and forth to see... And the hovering over each one to see what the change was, that's a big deal. It just removes all of that stuff.
Yeah, I felt like I set everything up for the tool belt. I love the tool belt. Even before there was the tool belt to customize, we were customizing the tool belt.
Right.
Because it's just so convenient and it's so worth it.
Yeah.
I felt like there was something missing that would make me want to do all the work to set up my skill tracker.
Yeah. I
don't know what that was.
I wonder if this can be done. I don't know, like, you know how, like, you can name your skills tracker? I named this one tailoring and the other one mining. I wonder if you can do the same thing for the, or if the devs can do the same thing for the tool belt. Like, what I'm finding is hard is knowing remembering which tool belt set was what.
Okay, for any dev that's listening, Adam has a very poor memory.
Yes, very.
Can't
poor
remember what number one to number nine or whatever. There's 10.
Yeah, zero
slots
to nine or whatever.
They don't mean anything to him. But if he could name the tool belts, that would help him greatly to remember that number five is his cloth tailoring.
Although I guess now that they added this little bar that allows you to scroll up and down between them, I suppose that's...
Yes, so I do like that too.
Yeah, that somewhat solves the problem. I haven't... Because that's relatively new, I guess. I haven't really played around too much with that.
Yeah. Anyway, skill tracker... is something that if you can use it, it helps so much. But it's about setting it up. I don't know. I found personally that it was just too much work for the amount of gain that I get. Mm. Kind of like if it did one more thing, like track. I don't know. How much... Here's a question. How much is too far?
Right.
For example, if we were to have the skill tracker track not only how much skill gain we've gotten this session, but how much skill gain we've gotten this hour.
Right.
And log every single hour I got this much skill gain, and then this hour I got this much skill gain, or half an hour,
or maybe giving an average like value for like how much skill you're getting each minute on average, and having that as a
updated... How much statistics would you want to be given in the game over the mystery, keeping that mystery alive, not fully knowing?
That's a hard one. Because one half of me is saying, oh, give me all that information. I would love to have that. And I know that people have programmed tools that do that for you. A lot of them are not Mac friendly, so I can't use them. But how I've wished for something to tell me all of the stats related to how much skill gain I'm getting per minute, or, you know, so that I can, you know... optimize my skill gain even more, you know? But the other half of me likes the mystery. Likes to wonder, am I doing it the best way? Let me try something else. Is it getting better? And then I still don't really have a measurable way of determining whether it's better, and so it's just about what you feel.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And both sides of you are too balanced, that one side doesn't win out.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a part of me is saying, like, once you know the answer, then
everybody's going to do it.
Everybody just does it that way. and there's going to be no variety in strategies. You know, it comes down to that that problem that WoW had, where once somebody figured out the most optimal talent tree there was, then everybody just switches to that talent tree and nobody even worries about it. I don't know.
Yes, yeah, so I don't know. What do you guys think in the chat? Do you want the game itself to be able to tell you the best optimal way of skill gaining? Or to provide you tools that allow you to figure this out? Or would you rather have it stay a mystery? So it's more about the feel, or you heard from a friend that heard from a friend, or I read it on the forum somewhere. Or do you want it just be like, exact, this is the way. We have all of these statistics to prove it that we found in the game. The game has told you.
You know, part of me likes to figure it out. But I, like, part of the figuring it out would be to have something that tracks this sort of thing, you know? Like, here's the one end. What I don't want to do is have to take this skills tab and just tally it up myself. You know what I mean? Like, go through the whole logs and just use a pen and paper and write down every time that I got a skill class, and trying to remember, you know, and using the timestamps and all, like, what tool was I using during this action that gave me that skill tick or whatever. Like, tracking all that stuff by hand would not be feasible. I would love to have the programming skills to program something that does all that for me, like parses logs and stuff like that, but I don't have the programming skills or the time to spend doing that. You know, part of me would just love that information to be given somehow. I don't know.
So it seems like people like the way it is. You like the way it is. Have our tools that do it, like Buddha's tool that he posted. What is it called? W-stat. W-stats.
Right, I gotta look at that.
So you can track. We like that we have these tools, but don't add it into the game as like a actual game mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
Keep it the way that it is. We have enough. And that leads to a whole other discussion that I've wanted to have, but has nothing to do with this episode. Windows. We have too many. Thoughts?
By that you mean event window, inventory window, that sort of thing?
I feel like over the last few years, we went from having a minimum amount of windows to having an over amount, abundance of windows.
Yeah, like the new select bar.
Anybody else think this? Is it just me? See, when we first started playing the game, this is actually one of the questions that we had. So let me bring this up. Ryan asked, how does the Wurm experience compare now to when you first started playing? Do you ever get nostalgic about anything? When we first started playing, there was so few windows. I even remember when you were killing something, there was no target window and there was no health bar.
Right.
You just went by what the animal's description was. So it was almost like, to me, when I visualized this, the way I visualized it was, okay, there's an animal and I'm hitting it. And now the graphics aren't good enough for it to visualize to me what I'm doing to it. But it's telling me what I'm doing to it. It's saying that it was healthy and now it's, what's the other ones?
Hurt.
I can't remember. Wounded. Hurt, and then it's bleeding, it's wounded, and eventually it dies. So I figured, okay, when they get around to it, what will probably happen is that instead of it telling me what it's doing, I'm hitting it and it's visually getting, you know, hurt until it dies. And there would be a number of visual cues that it'll look like this, and then wounded will look like this, and then bleeding will look like this, and then it dies.
Mm-hmm. So you would need, of course, you're talking about getting like a texture or a new model.
It would replace
model.
The description with the visual.
Yeah, but each level of woundedness would have a different model for that.
Different model, a different something. I don't know.
Textures.
I don't know how it works. Make it look wounded. Something that shows us that it's getting wounded, right? Because to me, Wurm is very visual. Even though it wasn't visual, like we had like the worst visuals, it was very visual. It was like very immersive. That's the word. I'm looking at the bear getting hit. I'm not looking at a window of the bear in the game getting hit.
Yeah.
You know, and I felt that was the difference between Wurm and a game like World of Warcraft. I was in the game and not in the game's window system.
Yeah. Except for there are times where in this game you're only in the window system.
Even when I'm looking in the inventory, for example.
Yeah.
We see items that could potentially be like in our bags that we're carrying.
Yeah.
We see that the icons, when I visualize it, I don't see, you know, the regular inventory system like other games. It's just part of the immersion. It's like the bag, the inventory is like a bag. So I open up a window, and that window is representing of the bag that we carry,
mm-hmm.
even though we don't actually carry a bag. Anyway, that's how I visualize. Everything makes some sort of sense.
So
I open
window,
up
this inventory window,
this
or whatever,
storage bin,
like...
and I can see inside of it. And the way I see inside of it is the window, is the bulk storage window that pops up. And a lot of things in Wurm, you know, has that sort of trait. I have a tool belt, and I put tools on my tool belt. So the window that pops up isn't like a window of slots. It's an actual tool belt that we see, and then we add tools to it.
Right.
So it's more immersive that way. Just like we see the compass.
I like how you can see the compass.
And that sort of thing. It was more, we see it because it's more of a immersion tool that we're using. It's designed in a way that allows us to be more in the game and less in the windows. So I thought that's the direction that Wurm will go. I don't know. I felt that's the direction I would like Wurm to go, I should say. And that's why I didn't mind right-clicking, because when you right-click something, you're right-clicking the item that's actually in the game. So you have this horse. I right-click this horse because this is the only way that we could possibly do this with the interface that we have right now. I right-click the horse, and then I can do something with the item that I just clicked on.
Mm-hmm.
I can do something with the horse that I'm clicking on. I'm not right-clicking an icon of the horse somewhere in a window or on, you know, some form of window. I'm right-clicking the horse. So if I were to upgrade, let's say, the interface, I would keep that in mind. I would keep in mind I'm going to design an interface that's better than this right-clicking that keeps me in the game and less in windows. And that's why I was sort of didn't really think of the crafting window when it first came out. I wasn't really 100% sure of it. Because it brings me out of the game, and it brings me into another window. So if I were to really be nostalgic of anything, is back when there wasn't so many windows.
Pre-crafting window, I think.
Pre-crafting window, not even crafting window.
Pre-target window.
Pre-all new windows.
Yeah, all new windows.
That's what got us into the game. If I were to design... This is why, if I were to design a crafting window, I would make it more a part of the actual game. For example, there would be something like... I would go to the forge, and I would set up... It would be a window that pops up that's just designed that for the forge.
It represents
for
the forge.
Smithing. Yes,
that's
right.
What you're saying.
That's why I'm not against crafting stations for carpentry and everything. Anything, really. If it was designed smartly, I mean, I go to this crafting station and I open up a window that's designed around this crafting station that allows me to be more immersed in that game, in crafting that way. Not saying we should take away the ability to craft while riding on a horse, but I like the idea of crafting stations. I hope one day they do get implemented in some way that gives us some form of crafting bonus for using them. I don't know. Something. And I'm not saying... See, I like the idea of right-clicking. You know what I would do? And I don't know if this could actually be implemented. See, I like the idea of staying in the game. So if you were to right-click something, it would still need to be a menu. See, I don't know. I don't know what I do.
Are you talking about... Were you going about to say a menu that sort of goes around your mouse?
Sure.
More visual to the menu, maybe? You know, like icons instead of words, like examine would be like an eye and...
Yeah, no.
No?
It would be more... I'd almost think that it would be a menu system inside the game. Inside the game world.
Yeah.
It would look... It would look maybe a little bit translucent. And whatever I click on, so let's say I click on the horse, then the menu system would be floating on the horse or around the horse, somewhere near the horse.
Yeah, that just gets a little bit flashy.
And it would just be in the game. So
as opposed to,
I don't know,
GUI,
or it could be,
say, right?
or it could be something that's. See, I don't even know if I like that. It could be something like representing of us as players in the game.
Buddha says, "Keep dreaming."
Yeah, I know. We're dreaming all the time.
This is what we do. This is what we do when we chat with each other. We're dreaming a lot of the time. This is us.
Something representing of us as characters in the game. What can we do? So the menu system would have to incorporated has to deal with keeping us in the game. Somehow. don't know if this is making any sense.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
we can't see us as characters.
Your common theme, I think, is that you like the immersion factor. So you want it so that when you're interacting with the world, it's something that
I want to interact with the world in the world.
Right. In the game environment as opposed to the GUI environment. Right? Is that what you're trying to say?
You're saying it's so technical.
Well, I know, I but that's the way that it needs to be said.
In the world.
Like in the 3D Wurm environment, where all the objects are.
I would just always keep that in mind if I was designing something.
Yeah. I know.
Right, for example, we build a house. I've seen games where, okay, I'm going to put down a house, so they zoom out, bird's eye view. We're going to place, like, you know, it's going to be this big. It's like playing The Sims or something. Mm-hmm. We're going to make a house this big, and then we're going to put walls like this, and well, now that it's done, boom, back into first-person view. And the house is done. But Wurm's not like that, right? You click the ground, and you're, like, actually putting the walls in, and you're setting it up like, that's Wurm. You're in the game.
And you're looking through your eyes, your character's
eyes.
Yeah,
yeah. That's what we like about the game. And by we, I mean me.
Yeah.
That's what I like about the game. I like being immersed in the world and feeling like you're actually doing what you're doing. And that's the one thing I didn't like about the crafting system. It felt less like I was doing it.
Right.
Even though it's convenient,
obviously. I really like the crafting system. Just put the record straight. I really like the crafting window. It's one of my top new additions that I really like. So, Brian and I don't generally hold the same opinion on things, and this is, I think, one of them.
Yeah. Yeah, this is... We usually don't agree on anything.
Anyway, so, why don't we talk a little bit about what you're doing? Because we can't see what you're doing.
Okay.
Guess.
Okay, so...
So what are you doing over there?
I am trying to level my natural substances.
Substances, yeah.
But there's no way substances... I'm saying this wrong. I'm so tired. Yeah. I literally got home again... And boom, started recording.
Yeah.
That's why I was a little late. So, there's no way to imp an item for natural substances. It's like the worst skill to level.
It's one of the worst. There's quite a few skills actually out there that are like that, where there's no item to imp that will give you that skill. And the only way to get the skill is to create. These I like to call the creating skills. Other skills that are like this are locksmithing, metallurgy, coal making, or is it coal? Yeah, coal making. So natural substances is one of them. And the only way to get it up is just keep combining, keep creating, keep just doing stuff. I think for natural substances, the best skill gain is healing covers.
Is there another way of doing it? When you say the best skill gain is healing covers.
There was one other thing.
Is there another way to level natural substances?
I remember finding another... one way is to make dye, but that's just horrible skill gain. Each combine is like horrible, horrible skill gain, and so... It would go like maybe the tenth the speed as healing covers would. Wow. Although my feeling is that they should increase the dye. Sorry, was that?
It's like I can dye items or I can make healing covers. These are our two options.
There's like another
mortar,
but
mortar and lye.
Right.
Making lye.
Right. More. Yeah, that's right. Mortar. Nah, mortar doesn't go to healing cover natural substances, but lye does. And that's just horrible skill gain too. It's also creation.
Really?
Yeah, and
making candles. Candles?
That's a good question. Candles. We have stuff for candles. We can test it.
Or we can look it up on Wurmpedia.
My feeling is that I've done a few things. I haven't done extensive testing, but I've just, you know, like combined like 10 of these items, and I looked, and the skill gain per combine word was nothing.
Natural. Okay,
to...
so candles and concrete.
Oh, concrete! Oh, goodness, goodness, goodness! No, man.
Listen, the reason why healing covers is the best is because you can use farming mats or tails and bladders and all this stuff, but and put them in bulk storage bins or food storage bins, you'd have thousands of them.
Right.
I think I like tails and bladders and stuff.
Personally, if I were starting from scratch, I would get 1,000 corn. Like, I would go buy maybe from somebody, 2 silver, 1,000 corn, 1,000 garlic. Boom, you have 1,000 actions right there. And that'll get you a good base for your natural substances. Here's another recommendation.
So really, there's no trick to this.
Garlic and combined fat. What does that make? Oh, farmer salve.
Farmer salve.
That might work.
That's
too.
A good one.
Farmer salve might work the same as healing covers, although I haven't tested that in a grinding situation.
Yeah, because I'm just using glands and tails, and what's great is that you can just combine one of them.
Wait,
so I'd have,
you
let's
mean
say,
bladders and tails? You're not using my glands, are you?
Glands or... maybe. I mean bladders and tails, that's what I've been using,
right.
Yeah. and you combine one of them, and the other one you leave, like, let's say I have 30... bladders and 30 tails, and you just combine what, like, the tails.
One of them, yeah.
You activate the tail, and then you right click the 30 bladders, and you hit whatever it's called,
right.
alchemy mix, and that queues up the amount of skills that you're allowed.
One thing I'd like to see is the natural substances, like, or the healing covers get put into the crafting window system. Because currently, you can't. It's all right-click menus like it was before. It'd be nice to see that go in. I don't know. There must be some reason that there's some problem with putting them in there, but...
Oh, there's apparently a trick.
For everything?
Specifically for a trick found by a stay-at-home mom.
You know,
I don't know
also
what that is.
And it was brought up in chat here that if you COC one of the items, it works. I think it matters which item. So what? One of the items acts like the tool, and one of the items acts as the, I don't know, material or whatever. Right. And if you put COC on one of them, then you get. And that works for metallurgy, that works for locksmithing as well. COC will help.
We use that tool while building our the Colossus. The Colossi that we've been made over the years. We would make a WOA clay. And then we would just combine a whole bunch of clay and just insert it into the Colossus.
Does Colossus take
for clay? Anybody wanting to make them lots of Colossi for some reason. It works.
Yeah, and that works for mortar too. WA on clay.
Yeah.
All right, so I have currently gotten...
So how have you been doing?
I've currently gotten these things up to... They're closing in on 50 when my skill is only 46.
Yeah, how long has it been?
I have just gotten 3 skill ticks. Or not 3 skill ticks, but 3 skill. 3.00.
And how long has it been?
don't know. I sort of haven't kept track. I can look at how long we've been recording for. We've been recording for an hour and 20 minutes or so.
Oh, wow. So you got 3 skills in about an hour.
So I'm averaging a skill per...
That's not too bad.
Yeah. That's not too bad at all. Now, cloth tailoring...
So let's do these questions, hey?
Okay, yeah, sure.
Unless you had something really important to say.
I was just about to say that cloth tailoring goes up pretty quickly. That there's a lot of skills that go up pretty fast. And I feel like the armor smithing skills go up pretty fast and that sort of thing. But whereas you'll find other skills going up really slow.
Yeah. So just because you're a 90, I don't know, platesmith, doesn't mean you should go and try weaponsmithing right after that. So let's do some of these questions. We have Brutus saying, how would you suggest that us as players who really enjoy the game persuade those who have come and played but fell asleep in their chairs, literally, and then moved on, into coming back to see what a joy the game actually is? We have struggled with this since the beginning of us playing Wurm.
Yeah.
What do you guys think in the chat? How would you get your friends to play?
Yeah, not only play, but just stay. You know, like, we've seen so many people come and go. And they would come, play for 3 months, they'd be so into it, but then it gets down to the long term. Like, there, you know, there's so few players that can make it past that, you know, 3 or 4 month mark and continue playing beyond. So I was thinking, I know we've answered the question a lot, like, how do we get our friends to play the game? But then, once they're playing, and they, let's say they enjoy the game, let's say they're having fun, but then they find that, okay, now I want to build a deed. Now I want to get my skill up. And it's a lot of grinding. And the question is, how do you get them to sort of overcome that? I don't know, it's a hard one.
Yeah, it's hard to keep you going. I think we've answered some of these in a previous video. I do feel that the game needs a little bit extra, and we've talked about this before, a little bit extra after you do the initial, after you get over the initial hump of, okay, I have my deed and I have my house that I want to build, now what? So we've talked about this before. And I think that it does need a little bit more to keep those players going. I'm not sure how much, but it's tough, right? The game is very niche, and you never know that if you even did have these extra features, would it keep those players, would it have kept those players around anyway?
Mm-hmm.
In the end, I think it has a lot to do with community. So any tools that foster community would allow those players to stay longer. Anything that fosters the, like, coming together or doing stuff together would help the situation.
Mm-hmm. I think that if you focus on community, and even like just our, if we as players, like, individually focus on building our community up, and that's one of the things I wanted to do here, is build the community. I think that will keep more interest around, because it's about interaction with other people, and that's the heart of this game, I feel.
Yeah, so I think the best answer, though, is the one in the chat that says all you have to do is lock them in the basement. I agree. Let's move on with that note. The next question is by... Did we do this question already?
Not quite.
Okay, so I believe the name is Subster. Subster? Yeah.
Subster.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I've played with a variety of people who have different views on skill gain, ranging from those who sit and grind one specific skill for hours, days, or weeks to attain a certain level, to those who simply gain skill as a side effect of playing the game, like fighting, building, or gathering. Where do you both feel you sit on this scale, and do you feel that skill grinding could be made more enjoyable than sitting at a workstation imping? If so, how?
See, I like this question. I've thought about it a lot, and I hear a lot of people talking about how they don't grind their skills, and they just let the skills naturally progress. I would probably place myself somewhere in the middle, but probably closer to the I grind my skills side. Because I do grind my skills. I do sit here doing this, what we're doing right now.
This episode is about grinding skills.
Yeah. And I find that, like, I don't know if maybe this might give you some idea. In this raft, this is what I've been doing. It's all my cloth gloves. So it's not like this is the first time I'm sitting down doing cloth tailoring. And I do this a lot. Like, I just grab a whole bunch of skills a whole bunch of items, and I just skill them up. Or grind on them. But at the same time, I also do a lot of deed building. And not a lot, but, you know, this place is pretty... took a lot of effort, and I'm currently... I don't know if you can... No, not from here, but if I back up here, I could probably see... I'm currently working on another section of another deed... it's behind all those trees back there. Anyway. And it's just, like, I enjoy deed building, and I enjoy building the houses, and I enjoy doing that stuff, and I think that with those actions, I also naturally get some skill gain. Like, for example, I've never skilled my woodcutting. But if we take a look at what my woodcutting is, like, I've never grinded it. It's at 50. So that's just from cutting the trees that I needed to cut from doing stuff. So, you know, I'd say I'm somewhere in the
middle.
You
do a bit of both?
Yeah, what about you?
So everyone does things a little different. You made a bunch of gloves and imped them. Doesn't mean you have to stick with gloves. You did it as a sort of way to optimize the amount of cloth that you use.
Yeah,
materials that you use.
At the time, I had maybe 50 cotton to work with, and I didn't want to waste it, sort of thing.
Right. Whereas, I mean, other people would make other items, mix it up a little bit.
See, here's the thing. Armor, cloth tailoring, I'm not doing cloth tailoring for the armor. I don't want the sets of armor or anything like that. If I wanted a set of armor, I'd make one, but I don't. What I'm mostly doing it for is things like tapestries and maybe meditation rugs at one point, but the carpets, the new carpets, that
right.
sort of stuff.
So you're leveling it up so that you can make those better.
Right.
And I don't know, what do I feel? I feel with the way that the game is right now, you will come to a point where you will probably play longer if you grind a skill.
Yeah.
Whether it's animal husbandry or cloth tailoring or natural substances or whatever, and you become good at that skill, you can only really become good at that skill with a good amount of time if you grind. And if you don't grind, you will probably be that person that doesn't play for very long, or you accept the fact that your skills aren't going to be that great and you're more like a builder or something.
Uh-huh.
And that, if that's the case, then you're going to be moving from place to place, building and then leaving and then building and then leaving. Grinding, at least for us, is a big part of the game.
Mm-hmm.
and it almost needs to be accepted as a big part of the game eventually. It's not something that you do right away, although you could. It's something that you learn. It's a skill that you learn in the game, and it's why we made videos or made this video about it, and it's why people talk about it. You don't naturally just know how to grind. It's not something that comes to you by playing the game, especially solo.
It takes a long time.
You read about it or you do something. Yeah, and then eventually you do it. It's part of the game. So could it be more enjoyable than sitting here and doing this? Yeah, but they would have to change a lot. And do we want that? Do we want them to spend the time to, I don't know, what would you do? Like, you would visually see you cutting the gloves with scissors? I don't know, if they want to continue with the actual system that they have now, what can you do with that? Or would you have to replace that system entirely to make it more interesting? Mm-hmm. I don't know. I like how it is. I think it could be a little more rewarding with the system that I talked about last week, with the whole enhancement system. But other than that, the system that they have in place is fine. In fact, I think it's a highlight of the game, the fact that every item can be improved upon. And you can level every item. It doesn't happen in most other games. And it's one of the highlights that at least you would talk about if you were talking to another player, especially if they were a fan of the crafting system in another game. I knew players that just played Vanguard just for the crafting system. And yet this game shatters Vanguard's crafting system.
Mm-hmm.
As far as depth and the way that it works.
I think this crafting system shatters a lot of other games.
Yeah, and it's just... Yeah, and then you have games like EverQuest 2. That's just...
Right.
Essentially, I remember just being like, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2... Yeah, that's what I was doing. Until the item was made. But... Which is okay, it was fun for a little while. But yeah, turning crafting into a little minigame? It's already a little minigame. Do we continue down this minigame and just make it more visually pleasing? Or do you change it completely into something else?
I think changing it completely would not be a good move. I think working with what we got and sort of making little tweaks here and there might be nice, but I like it how it is, to be honest. Although I, you know, that's just the way I've gotten used to it, and I enjoy it. So, yeah.
Yeah, we're just old. Oh,
maybe. I like how it allows you to do it, and you can like watch a show at the same time, or you know, do something else and imp. That's one thing I really like.
Yeah.
If they changed it where I had to pay full attention to the game to do it, that would not be good. That would change the way I'd have to play the game, and I don't know if
a lot of people would just stop.
Yeah.
I hear you. Okay, so next question. Oh man, I'm gonna butcher this name. Aaron Nicky? Is that right?
Aaron Nink.
Ninky.
He's in our chat here with us.
Okay. Well. In your experience, what should you use sleep bonus for in order to take advantage of the most skill gained?
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, the question is in general.
Yeah. I think that sleep bonus management is a big thing in this game. It's like you don't want to have it on 24/7, because then you'll be wasting a lot of that sleep bonus on time, which you're actually not getting that much skill. You know, but at the same time, you don't want to be sitting at full sleep bonus bar for lengthy periods of time, lest the server crash and you get nothing for for that. You're for sure going to be using sleep bonus for when you're grinding. So if ever you sit down and do what we're doing right now, sleep bonus on, as long as you have it.
Yes.
Other times that you want to put on sleep bonus is when you're doing things that are going to increase your characteristics up here. So, digging.
Like, what do you mean?
Yeah. Like, you're just digging clay. And you're not doing it for skill. You don't have a low-quality shovel or anything, but you have a high-quality shovel. And it turns out that digging, even with a high-quality shovel, is going to give you nice characteristic stats, even though it might not give you digging skill, because the shovel's high quality. Sleep bonus affects characteristic gains. So you might, if you have extra, like you're sitting at a full bar of sleep bonus, you don't have any plans for it in the near future, and you're going to go down and dig 1,000 clay or something, just popping sleep bonus then, wasting an hour or two of it there, that's I'd say it's well spent.
Here's one, correct me if I'm wrong. Repairing. Does the sleep bonus, you get double the skill for repairing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Get a whole bunch of stuff to repair, turn on your sleep bonus, and just start repairing it for a good while.
Yeah, especially if you have a cookhouse set up. And those pans need repairing on a regular basis. That's for sure.
Yeah.
And it's good skill, too. Like, even if you have high skill, repairing 1,000 pans, really good skill.
You can do one or two that you can make, like, 100 or 200 clay something, clay pots.
Yeah.
Clay bowls. And no, just keep them on the ground outside.
I don't think clay bowls. Oh, you mean like not heated?
Do not heat them.
Right.
And just and you just
another good one for repairing is backpacks.
Repair them. They
backpacks or satchels.
Backpacks or satchels?
Because those even on the for like outside. If they have 10 damage, it still has quite a long repair timer for each item. Yeah, off deed on the ground.
I don't know if it affects repair skill.
I think it does.
Like sleep bonus. I thought it did. I don't know. That was a long time ago. I haven't done this in a long time. I might have.
Zalafir says don't use it for meditation, realized. But you know, I think
some people do.
Meditation is such a slow skill that if you use it, it makes a big difference. The way that I do it is I'll have my sleep bonus off. I'll start my meditation action, which takes a whole whatever, however long it takes, 2 minutes. And right at the end, I turn my sleep bonus on, followed by an imping session. So I have all my imping set. Like, I'll have these cloth gloves sitting here, and I'm ready to go with my cloth gloves. I meditate, flip it on right at the end, and then I start imping. And then, you know, however long later, 30 minutes later, you know, I start meditating again. And I guess it might be looked at as a waste of 2 minutes, but when you get that tick of 0.3 meditation, but you didn't have your sleep bonus on, all you're thinking is, man, I could have gotten 0.6, you know?
Yeah. That's happened to me. Yeah. Anyway, next question. Freya has asked, my myth I would like debunked is about using one quality skill or tools for everything and the difficulty of ores while mining. I've heard a lot of conversations where false info is being spread that rock is useless to skill past 50 mining, and that mined ore quality between 1 and 39 is no longer valid. This is all about mining, so I'll leave this question answered to you.
Well, we did explain all this in our Optimizing Skill Gain episode that we referred to way back in the day, but I'll say it again. The 1 to 39, that's still valid. If you are mining and you mine something that's not between 1 and 39, so like, I think it's 1.01 and 39.99, any ore that's between those values, you will get a skill tick, regardless of the pickaxe you're using, regardless of anything. The idea is that when you're mining, you want the actions to be really long, and you want the result to be as most of those as possible. So that's all true, and we go through all the details in the other episode. So if you want to know more about it, go back. But one thing I do want to say is recently Kaneka, which is one of our villagers, did a little bit of testing on this and found, and this I found really interesting, she has pretty high mining, 90 or something like that. And what she found was that if you use a one quality pickaxe and damage it like a lot, like put 50 damage onto it, and with your high mining you go and mine rock, you're going to start getting better skill gain. Like, that damage affects the effective quality of the pickaxe, causing it to reduce the quality of the ore and rock coming out of it. And you could still get pretty good skill gain on the lower quality ores by doing that. So it's not about what level you are. It's about the combination between what level you are and what quality pickaxe that you're using and what ore that you're using it on, that will affect your overall skill gain. So, you know, I've heard of people using high quality pickaxes on gold at level 50. I've done it myself, and you still get pretty good skill gain, even though the wiki says gold, no dice. But, you know, so it all goes back to try stuff out, use your own experience. There's not really that much of a wrong answer as long as your skill is going up.
I think it's good to know.
That's all I'll say about that.
All right, so the last question. Yeah, there you go. If anybody wants to know, it's official. Just mine rock to 100.
Yeah.
You heard it here first. Anyway. Lexica has written, and I think we've decided, or you decided, to have this. This is the question of the week.
Yeah.
There you go. So you've won whatever Adam has deemed worthy. I don't know what item it is this week. But you've won, what is Lexica won?
It's an 80 quality saw with 90 WA. And some COC on it, I can't remember how much, but not as much, like 70 some odd.
Okay, so what is the question? The question is, Wurm is infamous for windows of opportunity, and by that I mean windows of opportunity, something that doesn't exist in many other games. How do you feel that these windows affect the game, and how newer players think of veterans who may have exploited skill gain loopholes in the past, which now require much more effort? Or on the flip side, many skills are much easier now to train than they used to be in the past, or they use less resources or something like that, or less failures or that sort of thing. What do you think of these loopholes or these sort of windows of opportunity that you could have gained lots of skill if you were just played or you were around here doing that skill?
Yeah, you know,
Do you feel like the skill should have been taken away from those players? Or do you feel that, I don't know.
It's hard to say. One example that I thought of was shield bashing. How shield bashing,
what about shield bashing
is so hard to level up now. And yet you hear about back when shield bashing didn't have a cooldown. You know, now it's like a 30-second cooldown. Whereas before, you could just sort of spam it after each other. And that, you know, people would get their shield bashing all the way up to 70. And then they changed the whole system so that getting it to 70 is just nearly impossible. I wouldn't say it's impossible, but it's just, it's such a hard skill to get up.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it makes a big difference, specifically with PvP. You go up against somebody who has high shield bashing, that's pretty much a game breaker in terms of you versus them. They're, because that skill stuns you. Knocks you over or whatever. So correctly time that, they can, you know, interrupt all of your actions. Anyway, another one that I heard was, I think it was forestry or something related to forestry. There was a time where that was a lot easier to get up, and then all of a sudden it made it harder. I don't know. So my feeling on this is there's like sort of two sides to it. There's the one side where if you never had that opportunity, you never were there when the window of opportunity opened, then yeah, you feel a little bit of resentment at the fact that other people have that skill that you weren't able to get, and now there's no way of getting it. But on the other side, if you are that player who got it, it I guess it adds an element of something that's nice for that player. You know, it's hard to say. Should the skill have been taken away? I don't believe so. Should the skill not have been changed? Well, it was changed for a reason. Maybe more of a gradual change should have been. You know, maybe not such a, like, a 30-second cooldown. That's kind of extreme.
You're really on that shield bashing.
Well, I mean, that's one of the big ones. Like, I can't think of another one that was as, that affects.
Can you affects think of another so much Can you in think our lives. Of another one? I cannot. Although I don't really think of these things.
What about not related to skill game, but windows of opportunity? One that we talked about before, and that's fountain pens.
Yeah, and we talked about that. And whatever the answer I gave in the last episode, I stand by it. Whatever it was. Anyway. There you go. Killing alts. It's all about PvP. Because in PvE, we don't really think about it. There's one. And I don't know if the skills were actually taken away from the players that were found, but there was a time,
very small
where fishing was bugged. Yeah. Fishing was bugged, and you could gain so much fishing skill. Like, the shortest amount of time. Your fishing skill was going up so fast.
Yeah.
You would just fish, and it would just be like, 1, 2, 3, 4. It would, like, go up. And people are like, I'm at 80 fishing.
Yeah.
And it was like nothing. They did hardly any fishing. So I don't know
if that skill got taken
what
away.
What happened with that?
I think that in a situation where a bug happens or an update happens and something changes unexpectedly and they figure it out like 2 days later and people have like in that time like gotten an insane amount of skill from it, I feel like that is a situation where you roll back. You know what I mean? Like, if it was unintended.
Yeah. It was probably rolled back. I can't remember.
But if it's, like, something that was part of the game for, like, 3 years, and then they decided to change it, there, that's where I don't think that you should roll it back or whatever, take away skill, because that was part of the way the game was intended at the time, and they made the change to prevent something. I don't know.
Yeah, who knows? Anyway, I think that sort of answers the question.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of, in some weird way. And with that, I do want to let's look at how much skill you gained,
mm-hmm.
both of us. So how much have you gained?
I just got to 4 levels.
All right. And with natural substances, I was at 22, and I just got 4 skill gains. So I'm nice. At 26 now. That's not too bad, right? Nice. And I think I made roughly around 120 or 140 healing covers.
Wow, that's pretty good. 140 each, healing covers.
Yeah. Each action is like 17 seconds.
Yeah.
So that's a long
natural
time.
Natural substances is not a quick one, that's for sure.
I mean, what's good is that it doesn't actually use stamina.
Right. Right. You know, another one that does that is butchering. Butchering doesn't use stamina either.
That's right, that's right. Yeah. So we both got 4 skill gains. That's not bad. Using our sleep bonus.
Yep.
Using your tools, high quality, you said, with COC.
Decent,
or
yeah.
You were saying with COC, WOA, doesn't matter.
I need to work on my scissors. But
for you. Yeah. And I don't know, that was a good session. But I think I'm ready to do an actual project. The project that we were talking about last week.
Mm.
What do you think? We'll do that sometime soon?
Sure. That sounds like a plan.
All right. So we'll build the labyrinth at some point. Hopefully next week. We'll see. We got to find a place first.
Yeah, I think that it'll...
So let's think of that. Let's think of that for the week.
Yeah. A lot of the first initial stuff is going to be boring to look at, but...
We'll start our labyrinth.
We'll bring some lively discussion,
I guess,
to that.
Anyway, thank you everyone for watching. Hopefully you'll join us next week. I'm really excited about next week.
Yeah, me too.
And are you ready? 26, I just got 0.25 skill or something like that. That's pretty sweet, right?
0.25 or 0.025?
I mean 0.25 in the last 10 minutes or so.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay.
Anyway, we should go. I'm getting tired. You're really getting tired.
Yeah.
Thanks everyone for watching. Thanks everyone for watching later on YouTube. We'll see you guys next week. Have a good one.